Thank you so much. Great being back in a live conference environment and not the online conferences like last year. That's the first thing. Second thing is thanks to the organizers for putting me on so early, because it's a pretty dense agenda I'm going to go through this morning. Maybe not the most exciting, but I'll try to make it more exciting and set some perspective on why this is important, right? So really, when we look at the broader scene, what's happening now with responsible AI, the practice, the policies, the guidelines, the legislation, let's remember that they are here for a purpose, right? And if we look first of all towards the EU and what is sort of the overarching legislation that we will see coming out in the next couple of years is the EU AI Act, as it's labeled. Really, the purpose of this is to ensure that the way that we use data, the way that we use models, not just AI models, not just machine learning models, but any type of models, the way we use that is responsible in terms of the human impact. So let's remember when we look at these areas that are a little bit dense, a little bit theoretical still, this is all about really a level of ethics, right? Then we can debate what is ethics, but at least this is responsible use of data and AI that I will share some light on together with you today. So really, going into more of the details that I want to look at today is how is the AI regulation evolving? And how fast is this happening? How soon are you going to be impacted? What can you do to make sure that you get ready? So a few points on the latest development of the legislation for AI, and that will actually be both the legislation and the standardization of AI, because those two things are coming together, which is fantastic. Then also, again, the broader perspective. So one thing is that the way I normally look at this is that within the EU, we started with data. GDPR came and is now being implemented. Companies are now starting to be fined if they're not compliant with GDPR. And then we went all the way out to AI and machine learning models. And what about all the technologies in between? Because there's a lot of technologies in between those two outer poles, so to speak, that the EU will also be looking at. And probably AI seems a bit scary, so the political scene went very fast there, but what about less impactful technologies? And then, again, this of course based on my experience, I'll give you some recommendations on what to do. Not necessarily that you have to do all of this now, but you have to consider what to do to comply with these legislations, what to do to comply with these best practices that you will see floating in left, right, center in the coming years, because you will need to do it. Because if you don't do it, someone will come at your doorstep at some point and say, you're not allowed to do this anymore, or this is bias, or this is misuse of data, whatever this might be. So you might as well start considering how to become compliant and familiarize yourself with some of these guidelines and legal frameworks. To set the scene, and this is not to sell my company to you, but I want to share with you the journey that we went through, because we were on the exact journey of starting to work with AI and realized that there was a new thing on the horizon and how we then had to deal with that. So really, our company is a AI company. We have we develop machine learning models for clients all around the globe, sophisticated, less sophisticated models. But we also have what is labeled today as an MLOps platform. So that's really the platform where developers can develop the AI models, deploy them, and operate them in production. And really the purpose of building this company for me and my team were to look into how can we accelerate the adoption of AI, machine learning, and other models for not the Googles of the world, not the Amazons of the world, but let's say more traditional companies, smaller tech companies, traditional companies out there. And I knew this from experience. I had been dealing with the AI machine learning for quite a while. And when I was dealing with that first, we had to code everything. There was no open source community out there. So we coded everything from bottom up, so to speak. That took a long time. That was a big hindering. Then the world changed a bit, and we had the open source community offering a lot into this this tech stack, but still very raw, right? So it's not like you can just count on the versioning. And the story I normally tell is that you have this data scientist with his Jupyter notebook standing, do the coding and all of that, build this fantastic model. And he goes down to the IT department and say, well, now let's take this into production. I say, look, and say, well, what are you talking about? What is that? Where's the security around that? What about the test procedures? What about the upgrade procedures? And then he will try to explain that, well, it's a very dynamic environment and I have to retrain and ingest new data. And they will just say, no, guys, this is not going to happen. This is not in this company. So that's one hindering. The other one is very much based around still the human factor, and that is that much of the modeling going on is still very much rooted in individuals and in individual data scientists. So what happens if you don't have a large team, one of your key members or more, they will leave you? Well, then a lot of knowledge will walk out the door and you're a bit stuck. So that's the whole point, shortening time to value. You see the numbers here from McKinsey, Gartner's has similar numbers and so on and so forth. But it's pretty sad that 80% of the projects, they sort of don't run after a relatively short time. Then what we realized were that in the horizon, there were actually a, if not equal, then at least to some people, new daunting task to be dealt with, and that was compliance. And compliance is a pretty, is another way of also ensuring that you follow certain procedures, and not a lot of discipline necessarily in the data science community around documenting things. Same for IT, right? Not documenting things, not really making sure that you had the right procedures and you could do it again and again and again. But what we realized were the real challenge here, we were dealing with the EU, were that it was not just the EU. It was a lot of people out there that wanted to have a say in this. So we started working on the ethical guidelines for trustworthy AI 3.5 years ago. That has now matured into the EU AI Act. But then we were also contacted by monetary authorities of Singapore, MAS, who wanted to do their thing, the ISO standardization, financial authorities, Meta, and everyone sort of have an idea about building guidelines, building the right standards in this area. And that really made me concerned, because one thing is to comply with one or two standards, but then if people could not agree around these standards, then you really have a challenge. And where the challenge became obvious to me were that we had a client in UAE, in Abu Dhabi, and they wanted to use the model we had developed for them all across the planet. And then we started looking into the number of legislations that they had to comply with, and that was pretty scary. So that's one point that I will elaborate quite a bit on a little bit later. But before going into that, let me just go back to Christopher Penn's keynote yesterday. I found that was very interesting, a very interesting keynote around COVID and new drugs. And this point about you needed sort of to involve the people, the business, the companies who knew something about the specifics within the data set and the use case that you were working on. And the key point, as I read it at least, or understood it, it was that you need to have these domain experts to guide you towards the relevant data you need to use. Otherwise, you'll just prove something that has absolutely no value for you. We found something else at the same time. I forgot the reference, but I can find it and put it in the slideshow afterwards. But really, it was a US study based on a lot of people moving out, doing a lot of experiments, and these experiments actually could have worked. 42 of them, but really what became a major issue is that when you start working with data in that sector, there's kind of an AI regulation also called the medical device regulation. There are certain things in this area where you really need to ensure how you document the way you work with data, how you document how you structure your model and build it and so on and so forth. So there was a very big problem. And that was, there was no model or data governance in that process. So even though that they had succeeded building these projects to cure small areas or large areas within COVID, they would never have been accepted by the FDA. So think about that and think about in many of the projects that you will be starting from now on, going forward, you need to think about the documentation, you need to think about compliance in a new way. Okay, let's look at what is happening right now. And I would say by coincidence, a lot has happened the last, I would say, 4 weeks in this area. So, development over the last couple of months, or last month, actually, in US and EU, is actually quite telling. So, two things happened: one in the US and one in Europe. And in US, there was from the White House a blueprint for an AI Bill of Rights. And that was also mentioned yesterday. You'll find similar things that we're used to from Europe, also around data, data privacy, and so on and so forth. And that's, of course, that's a development in one direction from the from the US that are very similar to the EU. But then if you look at what this is really, it's not really a law. It's more sort of a paper that is pointing in a certain direction. So the sentiment and comments very much around this afterwards were that it's a step in the right direction, but that's all it really is. So people are also a little bit confused in the US. Do they have to do this, or is this going to be voluntary, or? But it's a direction. If we at the same time look at what's happened in the EU, actually just the week before, that moved pretty fast forward, because in the EU people are now really starting to enhance and prepare for the EU AI Act. And there was now a new liability rule of products and AI to protect the consumer. So it's much easier for the consumer to sue anyone who doesn't comply with this. And let's go back again and think about the penalties for not being compliant with the EU AI Act. For GDPR, you can be fined up to 4%. Of your global annual turnover. That's pretty heavy. But for the EU AI Act, it's up to 6%. So the EU is really taking this super, super, super serious. So in US, still discussing, having sort of best practices in EU moving into law, moving into a very direct way on how to sue producers of AI that are not compliant. What is happening in the EU on top of that? And maybe you have all heard about it already, or you will hear towards the end of the year, but there will be the Digital Service Act, Digital Market Act, and these will be very big subjects for everyone working in the digital economy across Europe. A lot of changes to European companies, US-based companies, companies from all around the world who wants to do business in the EU. Good, enough on that. On to changes and what we're seeing, and also about maybe some overarching themes from organizations. So let me go back a step here. So we were talking about the EU and the US, differences between those also. But think about this as the OECD, WHO, all of those larger organizations are also having their councils, also building these overarching frameworks. So let me dig into one of these. That, and of course now you look at this, a CERN Select JTC21 Artificial Intelligence. What is that, right? But what's interesting about this initiative, and I know quite a lot around this initiative because I'm on the board of this, is that it's actually trying to do something that is new into this whole myriad of legislations and guidelines, is trying to combine some of this now. So the good news is that now people are starting to realize what I was talking about, that a lot of things are happening. EU councils, EP, US, the what, a lot of things are happening, but how am I then gonna comply with that? So what's happening now is that the legislators and the standardization organizations are starting to work together very fast. So this is the first time that within just 2 to 3 years, you will see that the standardization and the legislation will go hand in hand. So that's good news, right? But it's not going to happen again overnight. But the good news is that everyone is realizing this is a daunting task for anyone who needs to comply with this. Good. This more for notes. I'm not going to read through this. But again, this is just how this initiative is really consolidating across the line. And then to confuse you even more, just last week, there was these organizations in Germany and France and saying now they're going to have their standard way of looking into this and propose a way to comply with the EU AI Act. So my only point with this, again, don't read through this, is that there will be a lot of this coming out. Keep focus on what you see from the EU and the standardization organizations and the combination of that. Good. So another big thing, again, you don't need to read through any of this, but it's an initiative in the EU around sandboxes, AI sandboxes. That's pretty interesting because in the EU AI Act, it's clear that each of the member countries will have to set up a legislation or a local legal body who's going to authorize or not authorize the use of a certain AI model. That has to run through tests. I'm going to give you an example of that in the next slide. But before you actually go in and test and ask for validation certification of your model, you can take the model into a sandbox. The sandbox can be more or less digital, but at least the concept of having these sandboxes is now popping up in the EU. Very interesting. And the reason why it's interesting is because in the EU now, people are taking this as an opportunity to sort of counter the argument that we heard for quite some time, that with the legislation, we are gonna harm the innovation in the EU with AI, machine learning, and other types of models. So the point is that the idea now with the sandboxes in many of the countries will not just be to see if you can qualify, validate, certify your model against the EU AI Act, but also to do innovation. So the sandboxes will be a level of legal validation certification, but also an environment where the EU will try to make AI innovation to flourish. And that will be super, super interesting. And there will be much more around that in the coming months, beginning of next year. Now, currently in the lead is Spain in this area, but you see sandboxes popping up in Belgium, the Netherlands, Czech Republic, Norway, and France. So this will be very, very exciting to follow, because that will be potentially a way to accelerate AI innovation across the EU. Now, again, not to take the last energy, the last light out of your eyes, but just let me run through very quickly what it really takes to stay compliant with such an EU AI Act. Because in many cases, what you will have to do, or you will have to do it in this case certainly, is to go in and look at the EU AI Act, answer some questions. That could be different types of assessment, but in essence, you have to answer a range of questions, and you have to sort of self-assess if your model is high risk, medium risk, low risk. High risk, you run into a procedure of having to start measuring a lot of technical details on your model. Medium risk, you don't really have to do it. Low risk, you certainly do not have to do it. But if you fall, or your model fall in the high risk category, and the estimate from the EU is that between 15 to 20% of all models will fall into that category. And don't think that there are certain sectors that this is specific for. It goes across sectors. This is all about the human impact. So it's not just financial sector, it's not just healthcare, life science, public sector. It can be any sector. It also depends on how you deploy and you use your model. Well, then it starts to be a little bit more complicated, because now you need to gather all of these, I call them model operational technical measures. You need to start looking into the details. Is the bias within a certain range, or is there too much bias? And there will be certain questions around data drift, and there's going to be a lot around that, right? And then if you want to continue to use your model, you have to comply with what the EU defines as post-market surveillance. And that means that you constantly have to monitor your model, also in production, and feed back certain information to the authorities to make sure that you stay within certain boundaries, guardrails that has been set. And then when you retrain your model, you have to do it all over again. And here lays, of course, the bigger challenge, right? Because if you have to do this by pen and paper every time, you're probably gonna knock yourself out in terms of pen and paper and time spent on this. So a key point here is really that pen and paper are not gonna cut it going forward for managing these models and stay compliant. So back to my earlier point around regulations, and I think what is popping up now also with the EU AI sandboxes is the point that, well, if I have done this model and I'm a drone operator, should I go in the data sandbox and validate that I am compliant towards the GDPR, the EU AI sandbox, or the drone sandbox, and they're all out there. So the point from the sandboxes and in this slide is really that you have to be aware also that there will be multiple different types of regulations that you need to really think about. Let me give you some examples of this. So this is a project we're running in Denmark, and in Denmark the healthcare sector wanted to share anonymized data for quite a while to do drug discoveries and other things. But it didn't happen, and I had simply no idea why did this not happen. A lot of money were invested into this, but the problem were the one I just illustrated that, well, then you have the GDPR that you have to take care of. Then you can anonymize some data, but then you also have some challenges on the people who want to be working with this on the other side, developing the models, because they have their internal procedures. If they're Fujitsu, Siemens, and others, they have pretty strong procedures that they need to document also. And then you have the local sort of healthcare law that you also need to comply with. So the problem had been that no one in their right mind could sit down and find a way to document this in a dynamic way. So that's a big challenge. So key point here, you need to have some dynamic, and you need to respect that there will be, you have to have this dynamic, not just because there's multiple laws, but also because there's going to be a lot of changes to them in the coming years. So another project here that we saw from the EU, very interesting, around disruptive technologies. So note, it's not around AI, it's a much broader definition all of a sudden. So project to see how will these disruptive technologies influence the decision making towards our clients, patients, whatever this might be. And what we're seeing now is, again, we had the EU AI Act or AI out here, we had data here. Now we'll be looking at all the technologies in between. So in the coming years, all the technologies in here, as long as they have an impact on human beings, will be regulated in some shape or form. What we're also seeing is, as mentioned, maturing private initiatives. This is not secret anymore, this is Fujitsu. So we're starting to see that large international companies will try to push out their own impact assessments, their own ways of, if you want to do business with me as Fujitsu, there are certain things you need to comply with to be a sub-provider. And if you don't comply with it, you cannot continue to provide me with data intelligence and so on and so forth. Very interesting. Good. Let me try to summarize a bit here. What do you need to do? Well, as mentioned, you need to respect that it's not going to be one law, two laws. It's going to be a lot. They will be dynamic. So really what you need to do is you need to think about also within your organization, no matter if it's a big or small organization, you need to connect the stakeholders involved in this process. Right? So it's not just the data scientist. It's not just the governance function. It's all the stakeholders. And you need to involve them during the development process. And that's the problem, and was the problem in many of these projects during COVID, were that no one took notes or registered anything when they started looking at data, for example. So you need to say, okay, we're looking at these data. Have we done some checks on these data? Who has within the organization approved that we can be working with these data, and so on and so forth. If we ingest new data, what's the process for that? And so you have to start all the way out there. Because if you don't, it will be a hindering later when you have to report back to the EU AI Act at the point of trying to be certified with that, for example, or the Fujitsu's assessment. I said, pen and paper are not going to cut it, so you need to think about a way to automate some of this documentation. What I mean by that is the more documentation you can get in a digital format, the more information where a human do not have to sort of use the pen and paper, but you can actually validate with a digital trace that, well, we did check for bias, or we did give this person this approval at this point in time, the better, of course. And then what we're seeing, which is a bit of a surprise, I don't know if it's a surprise, but even in the larger financial institutions that have been dealing with traditional models for years and years and years, they still struggle to say who's responsible for this. So no one really likes that the spotlight is being put on them and saying, now you sign off that we've done this the correct way. And this is, of course, because there's a lot of learnings to be done across the organization. So you need to think about how you, in a group, sort of can sign off on the risk and that you're compliant. Good. I'm not going to go into all the details around that larger, dense slide here, but it is just to say that no matter what and how you look at this, the legal requirements, you cannot escape. You have to comply with them, or someone is going to close down the way you use your models or your data. Then a lot of debate on the ethical principles, and I did not spend too much time on that today, a little bit in my intro. But please remember also to think about what we're seeing now is not done just for the fun of it from regulators, but it is actually to ensure that we behave in a ethical manner with the way we use data and models. Code of conduct, example Fujitsu, we want our sub-suppliers to do it in a certain way, of course also complying with the rest of this. Rules, risk management, and then I mentioned the digital trace. So digital trace, the more you can generate of this, the better. Think about this case where you have to answer this question, did you check for bias in the data set? And by mistake, you say, yes, we have done that. 12 months later, something really bad happens in terms of bias. The whole company is going to be shamed across the board. So that's not very good. So really digital trace and for validations. So what can you do? Well, if you have to look only in one direction, look towards the EU, the EU AI Act, what's happening there. And then really carefully consider the ethical and responsible side of this and how you use your AI and really consider the consequences. A lot of what if questions have to be asked already from the outset of thinking about planning how to develop your models. As mentioned a couple of times, more regulatory complexity, more frustrations in the next coming years. But I really also see hope, and I'm super optimistic now, as mentioned, that organizations, legislators are starting to work together. And mentioned also, and people are very open about this. This is not going to be carved in stone anytime soon. This is going to change. So what is the point? What is the key takeaway, or my last takeaway on this at least? You must have a very dynamic framework to this. And you must start thinking about this risk thing. What is it when we work with data and AI? Yes. I think that was it. I don't know what the normal procedure is, but we have a couple of more minutes if anyone would have a question that they really need an answer to, then I will do my best to answer that.